7 out of the top 15 US cities with most foundation failures are located in Texas. There is a reason why residential foundation failures are more common in this area. The American Society of Civil Engineers estimates that as many as 1 in 4 homes undergo some kind of foundation damage due to this particular issue. In this video, we will explain why these areas suffer more than others and what are some mitigation techniques that can be implemented. Frequent foundation problems in residential units are not limited to Texas. The UK in particular has struggled with foundation problems for many decades. The Association of British Insurers estimates that foundation problems cost the insurance industry over £400 million annually in Britain alone. Australia, India, and South Africa are other notable examples where foundation issues incur major construction costs. All these regions have one thing in common, that is, a specific soil type covers a big chunk of them. The soil in question is an expansive clay with high potential for swell and shrink. Before we dive into the problem and mitigation techniques, we need to understand the behavior of this clay. This video will focus on the southern United States, though the concepts here also apply to other regions mentioned earlier in the video. Expansive clays are commonly found in the Gulf Coastal Plain due to a combination of geological and environmental factors. This region was covered by shallow seas in the Cretaceous period more than 65 million years ago. Over millions of years, the seas deposited marine sediments and formed sedimentary rocks. Over time, these rocks underwent chemical weathering where the parent materials break down into smaller particles forming clays. But not all clays exhibit this problematic swell behavior. A specific combination of pressure, temperature, chemical reactions, as well as volcanic activity resulted in the formation of a mixture of minerals known as smectite. Smectite is the culprit of this video, responsible for the majority of the residential foundation damage. Smectites have a layered structure composed of cations sandwiched by negatively charged sheets. This entire assembly is held together by weak electrostatic forces. When water is added to the soil, the water molecules hydrate the sandwiched cations, leading to a decrease in the electrostatic forces and separation of the plates, which is manifested as expansion of the clays. If confined, which is often the case when there is a foundation on top, the soil will exert an uplift pressure on the foundation. The magnitude of the pressure mostly depends on the amount of water adsorbed and type of swell minerals present. The uplift pressure can range from 100 kilopascals, which is about 2,000 pounds per square foot, for soils with relatively low swell potential, to an astounding 800 kilopascals or 17,000 pounds per square foot for soils with extremely high swell potential. Note that a typical residential two-story house weighs less than 1,000 kilos per meter squared, which is about 200 pounds per square foot. So its weight is no match for the uplifting forces of the soil. But the issue is not solely due to the uplift or subsidence of the soil. What causes most of the damage is the differential heave of the underlying strata. This can happen if there is a prolonged period of drought followed by heavy rain. In that case, the soil on the perimeter of the house gets saturated much faster than the soil underneath the center of the house. This causes the outer soil to expand much faster than the soil under the center. This differential movement generates very large forces and cracks within the slabs, beams, or walls that are part of the foundation assembly. The phenomenon is also reversible, where a quick drying can cause faster shrinkage and settlement of the perimeter of the house. This is the main reason why foundation failures often originate from the corners of the house, since the soil under the corner undergoes the fastest change in water content due to it being exposed to the outside environment on two sides. Unfortunately, the issue is not limited to this. Vegetation can also contribute by sucking out water from the soil and leading to shrinkage and subsidence of that part of the yard. In extreme cases, the shade cast from a tree or the house itself can cause less evaporation and also contribute to differential settlement. The grading and the drainage system are also crucial. I will talk more about them in the mitigation section near the end. The issue of expanding soils was first documented near the end of the Second World War. By the late 70s, the understanding of expansive soils was good enough to avoid this phenomenon. The design usually revolves around one or more of the following concepts. Provide a stiff enough foundation to accommodate differential vertical movements without a failure of the reinforced concrete. Alternatively, the foundation can be designed to isolate the structure from the expansive soil. One example of this is a structure supported on piles with a void between the soil and grade beams, which accommodates expansion and shrinkage of the soil over the life cycle of the house. Lastly, the soil can also be targeted to provide stability and a reduction of its swell potential. The design of foundations and floors on expansive soils are more complex than regular foundations. The added complexity usually leads to a costlier construction and motivates developers to cut corners. My personal experience with contractors is that if they believe that their actions are inconsequential, they're much more willing to take risks for higher profits. I have seen contractors slack on proper compaction because they do not fully understand its importance. I can definitely imagine some of these risks reappearing when dealing with expansive soils. On some other issues, based on experience, contractors do have a much better feel of the problem than engineers do. I'm very much interested to hear your experience on this subject. If you have dealt with foundation problems before, feel free to describe your case in the comments and how you dealt with the situation. I read 100% of the comments and try to interact as much as possible. I'm hoping for first-hand information and a healthy discussion with a variety of solutions. Speaking of solutions, let's see what options are there for mitigating this problem. Underpinning is a commonly employed technique that consists of installing new foundation elements that transfer the structural loads to a different, usually deeper and more stable part of the soil strata. This is usually achieved by installing piles around the perimeter of the house upon which the grade beams are later attached on. This way, a void can be created between the foundation and the expanding soil that will accommodate any future expansion and contraction. For this technique, it is crucial to minimize the skin friction on the piles. In other words, the piles need to be isolated from the expanding soil such that they remain unaffected by any future uplift. This technique is only possible if the existing foundation elements spanning between the points of underpinning are strong enough to carry the loads from the superstructure, essentially acting as beams. In the case of a slab on grade foundation, the remedial measures are much more difficult, especially if the slab has failed due to lack of stiffness. Underpinning a flexible slab would punch right through the concrete, creating even more issues. In some cases, beams can be constructed under the slab and be used as supporting points for underpinning, but as you can imagine, this is a difficult and risky task. Moisture control techniques can be employed to ease up differential movement of the soil by reducing the fluctuations in water content and providing a more uniform heave motion. Horizontal and vertical moisture barriers are often installed for this purpose. The horizontal barrier consists of an impermeable membrane or a rigid concrete slab installed around the perimeter of the house to guide the water away from the foundation. Subdrains are installed at the edge of the barrier to prevent ponding. Similarly, the vertical barrier consists of an impermeable membrane, but this time laid vertically in an excavated trench. The purpose of both of these techniques is to extend the seepage path and therefore slow down the rate of moisturizing of the soil. It is worth noting that even a perfectly impervious moisture barrier will not eliminate the moisture in the soil. Water migration due to thermal transfer and capillary rise from underlying soils will introduce moisture in the soil regardless of any moisture barriers. Furthermore, moisture barriers are not a remedial measure in itself. Structural repairs must be included to repair any damage that has already been incurred. Repairs are usually done after the soil movement has stabilized. However, reaching an equilibrium condition may take several years depending on the situation. These are only a few of many potential solutions for this problem. Unfortunately, none of them have a 100% success ratio. Local contractors specialized in foundation repairs are usually best skilled to judge which solution is best suited for a particular case in their area. If you like my content or you found it useful, consider buying me a coffee on the link in the description. Thanks for watching and don't forget to like and subscribe.